Hello, my name is James Armstrong and I am a teacher of politics. In this episode, I'm going to talk about the 1992 election. So this is a really interesting election because it's a very close election. Labour go into the election expecting to win. They're ahead in the polls and they remain ahead in the polls. And the BBC exit poll on election night, so this is the poll that's taken on election day, actually points to a Labour victory, and the exit poll is wrong. The result is that John Major wins the election. It's a modest majority of 21 seats, which is going to cause trouble for him in the future, because if you've only got a majority of 21, it means that it only takes a very small rebellion for you to start losing votes. But he wins, and that is unexpected. So that's what makes it quite an interesting election and one that's worth looking at. First of all, let's look at the context. So as I've just said, John Major is leading the Conservative Party. He had replaced Mrs. Thatcher in 1990. Margaret Thatcher resigns, not really through her own choice. Essentially what happened in her third term is that she began to dominate her cabinet more. She was pushing through more extreme policies that were very unpopular, like the poll tax, which led to a mass campaign of civil disobedience. People were refusing to pay the tax. There were protests in central London. They led to the poll tax riots. And if you've ever seen scenes of the poll tax riots, police charging at people on horses, it was almost like a civil war in London during some of those events. So Mrs. Thatcher steps down, and she steps down, as I say, because she loses the support of her cabinet. In particular, she loses the support of Geoffrey Howe, her foreign secretary, and Nigel Lawson, her Chancellor of the Exchequer. And she's replaced after a leadership election by her chosen candidate, John Major. And that's going to be a bit of a problem for Major, because Mrs. Thatcher returns to the backbenches. Major himself is seen as, yes, a fresh face, but he's seen as her chosen candidate. And so any criticism that comes his way from her is going to be damaging to him, and that's going to really affect his leadership going forward. Now, he finds himself in 1990 when he takes over, having to immediately confront a situation in the Middle East. Saddam Hussein had invaded Kuwait, and it leads to the first Gulf War. So right at the beginning of his leadership, he's confronting a major international situation. Britain, alongside America and lots of international allies, goes to war with Saddam Hussein to reverse that invasion of Kuwait. So he's a wartime prime minister in a sense. And just like with the Falklands War, being a wartime prime minister does help John Major, I think. He immediately abolishes the poll tax. So this really unpopular policy from the Thatcher years, it's gone, it's replaced. And what he's trying to do there is distance himself from Mrs. Thatcher. He's trying to be his own man. He's trying to make a fresh start in people's minds, moving the Conservative Party on from a leadership that had become toxic in people's minds. Mrs. Thatcher had become very unpopular. In 1991, there is a recession. Not a very big recession, but a recession nonetheless. And so when the 1992 election happens, the recession is still going on. And so the Conservative Party are not going into the election with the economy in a good place. And Labour go into the election ahead in the polls. So there's lots of indications here in terms of the economy, in terms of the polling, to suggest that this is an open door for Labour to win. And actually, there had been modernisation of the Labour Party. Neil Kinnock had spent his time taking on the militants, so-called militants, on the left of the party. He'd rebranded the party as well. So the red flag of Labour was replaced with what we now have as the logo, which is a rose. And he presents a centrist manifesto. One issue with the manifesto, though, is that it goes into the election promising to tax more and to spend more on public services. And this allows the Conservatives to argue that Labour haven't changed. So the Tory message is clear. If you vote Labour, you're voting for tax increases. Labour, on the other hand, spend their campaign highlighting high waiting lists in the National Health Service. In other words, the length of time that you sit and wait in an accident emergency department to see somebody, the amount of time it takes you to get a cancer operation or to see your GP. And they're wanting to highlight the fact that they're going to be the party that's going to look after the NHS and spend more on public services. And the campaign ends with a triumphalist rally in Sheffield, where Neil Kinnock is screaming into the microphone.
We're all right! We're all right! We're all right!
And there's an adoring crowd. And it's not a good look. It's not a good look. It looks like he's treating the election as a foregone conclusion. And, you know, he looks a bit deranged. It's not the sort of measured prime ministerial look that you want to be projecting about yourself. Meanwhile, Major is taking this election campaign very seriously. There's an election video that focuses on Major as an individual. He's an unusual Conservative leader. He went to a comprehensive school. He never went to university. He comes from a really humble background. He was brought up in a council estate. So this is not a typical Tory leader. And he really wants to emphasise that. He wants to emphasise his own background as a reason to vote for him. And that seems to work for him. He also goes around the country giving speeches from an upturned box, a soap box, touring the country, taking the campaign really seriously. And so you've got a bit of a contrast there between the two. You've got the triumphalist Kinnock and the scrappy John Major, even though he's Prime Minister. Now, typical of everything we've said about elections, when it comes to the media, Labour still have a huge disadvantage. And I think this is potentially quite critical in this election, compared, for example, to 1997, where Labour win over the support of the press, particularly the Sun newspaper. In this election, only The Mirror and The Guardian are backing the Labour Party, and The Sun, which has a readership of between 3 and 4 million readers, it's the most read newspaper in the UK at this point in time, The Sun goes after Kinnock. And so they put Kinnock's head in a light bulb and they say, if Kinnock wins the election, will the last person in Britain please turn out the lights? In other words, this is going to be a disaster. And of course, they're joined by the rest of the right-wing press, as we've come to know, looking at, if you've watched my other videos, that is. So only the Daily Mirror and The Guardian are supporting Labour. All of the rest of the press is attacking Kinnock and campaigning for a Conservative victory. And as I've said, the result is that despite the fact on election night that the exit poll, the poll conducted on election day, says that Labour's going to win, the polls get it wrong. They get it badly wrong. The Conservatives win. It's only a majority of 21. Which is a little bit unfair to Major, actually, because this is an election where, in terms of the number of people who vote Conservative, this is the best the Conservatives have ever done in terms of that raw number of votes. It's over 14 million votes for the Conservative Party. So why does the election go as it does? There isn't really a mainstream view here about why Major wins. There are lots of different views. One view might be that it was to do with John Major himself. He was more popular than his party. He was more popular than Kinnock. And that might have had something to do with his own background. He wasn't a typical Conservative leader, as I've said. He was from a working class background himself. He didn't go to university. If you think about the backgrounds of prime ministers of this country, many of them private school educated. I think 18 went to Eton. Many of them went to either Oxford or Cambridge. So typically, prime ministers come from a very narrow social background. Major is much more of a man of the people. He's an ordinary person who's risen through the ranks of the Conservative Party. So his popularity is important. As I've said, the opinion polls showed the race was close, and many people in the press, many people in the media were saying Labour were going to win. Now, if you're a Conservative voter and you think that Labour are about to win an election, what are you going to do? You're going to go out and vote. And actually, the turnout for the Conservative Party, as I've said, it's a very high turnout election, actually, this one, which was helped by the fact that it was a nice sunny day on election day. There was no rain. As I've said, this is the most number of people in terms of raw numbers vote Conservative in this election. And so is it possibly the case that the opinion polls scared the Tory voters and meant that they went out to the polls? Another possibility, and maybe lots of these factors sort of work together, another possibility is that people still just didn't trust the Labour Party. There was still quite a lot of division within the Labour Party, lots of arguments still going on between the left and the right within the party. And yes, Kinnock had done a lot to deal with that, but perhaps he hadn't done enough. Perhaps these divisions within the Labour Party were still significant in people's minds. And further to this, it's still a manifesto where the Labour Party are committing to put taxes up and spend more. And that the absolute central attack that the Conservatives always go for against the Labour Party is they're going to tax you more. So maybe people just felt that Labour hadn't changed enough, that the modernisation that had gone under Kinnock hadn't gone far enough, that it was still the same old Labour Party with some cosmetic changes, such as the logo changing to a rose. Finally, and again, quite importantly, I think, especially if you compare with 1997, Kinnock is still dealing with a media that is hostile to him. So coming back to this Sun newspaper and that putting his head in the light bulb, the day after the election, the Sun newspaper said, on their front page, they said, it's the Sun what won it. In other words, they were saying, we're the reason why the election has gone the way that it has. We're the reason why John Major has won a majority. So maybe it was the press. Now, I guess my view is that it's a mixture of these factors. And so there isn't really a simple explanation of what happened in this election. John Major was popular. Turnout was high amongst Conservative voters. The Labour Party hadn't modernised as much as under Blair, and the press was still hostile. Well, all of those factors together are going to make it difficult for are going to make it difficult for Labour to win. It's also an interesting election. Coming back to what I said at the start, people often will say about elections, if they're coming up with a theory as to why an election would go a certain way, they will often say, "Well, it's all about competence," and you can see, you can tell a story about competence. You can say, well, Callaghan lost in 79 because of the winter of discontent. Major ends up losing in 1997 because of Black Wednesday. And the Labour Party lose their grip on power in 2010 because of the financial crisis. You can tell a story like that. But this election doesn't fit that story very well because the Conservatives are going into an election during a recession. So if this was an election about competence, you'd expect that people would blame the Conservative Party for that recession. And maybe they do a bit. They only hang on to power, but it doesn't fit neatly into that narrative that lots of people tell about elections. Okay, so that's 1992, brief summary of it. Next time, I'm going to talk about the election that we've all got to study, the 1997 election. I'll see you then.